Okay, so hello everybody, welcome again to the fourth session of these lectures. And so in the past two lectures, so we've gone over the idiom formulation. I've gone over the essential details of the idiom formulation. So let me summarize all of those today for you in a sort of an algorithmic kind of way. So we start from the Einstein-Hilbert action. One over two kappa. And then we do the what is called the foliation. We perform a splitting of space-time. And so at each point in space, we introduce a time-like vector field at each point, t mu. And then we split this time-like vector field into two parts, one of which is again time-like, and the other is purely spatial. And then we can define this also gives us a splitting of space-time into hypersurfaces, or foliation in terms of hypersurfaces. Which is a unit time-like normal. Then this function n is called the lapse. And n mu is called the shift vector. In terms of these quantities, we can write down the metric tensor for the full space-time, the full four-dimensional metric tensor, in the following way. Where mu nu are the indices of the full four-dimensional space-time, and a, b, and so are spatial indices which belong to the hypersurface. Then we define this projector, which also turns out to be the spatial metric on the time-like slices, space-like slices. Using this projector, we can define various quantities such as the three covariant derivative, which is obtained by projecting the covariant derivative. Then the full four-dimensional covariant derivative. Then we can define the three Ricci scalar. Well, first we do the three Riemann. Which is defined in the usual way as the failure of the covariant derivatives to commute on a spatial hypersurface. And then we can use our projection identities to write down this expression to explicitly in terms of the covariant derivatives. When we do that, what we find is that there is a relationship that is obeyed by the four Ricci scalar in terms of certain quantities, which I will just remind you again what they are. And these quantities are where KAB is equal to HA nu, HB nu, grad nu. So it's the covariant derivative of the normal time-like vector field projected down onto the spatial manifold. Now there are a number of non-trivial facts about this KAB. One is the fact that KAB is symmetric. This uses something called the Frobenius theorem, which says that if you have a hypersurface, it gives you certain properties of hypersurface orthogonal vector fields. And then what you do is you can take any such tensor and write it as a sum of a scalar part, a symmetric traceless part and an antisymmetric part. And the Frobenius theorem tells you that if this vector is orthogonal, hypersurface orthogonal, then the antisymmetric part of this tensor must necessarily vanish. So you can also realize this sort of intuitively, because if you think about what it means to have an antisymmetric part of this tensor, right? It is like it is saying that you basically have a rotation, right? This object has a rotation, right? So after projecting these quantities down, you get a three-dimensional tensor, right? And so the thing is that the statement is that, you know, if it has an antisymmetric part, well, that corresponds to having a right, where this is the notation. Is it not updating? There's some lag. Am I audible?
Yes, you are.
Okay, there's some lag on my display. Okay, now it's showing up. Okay. Where this notation with the square brackets, what it means is you take the antisymmetric part of any object. If you take regular brackets, round brackets, that gives you the symmetric part. So this means that this vector has some rotation in it, right? And the thing is that if it has rotation, then as you imagine going up from this hypersurface, right? If you imagine just going orthogonal to this vector surface, then your vector field can't have any rotation, right? If it has any rotation, then it necessarily has to be non-orthogonal, okay? So this is kind of a very, very rough proof of this. Or it's not really a proof, but heuristic justification for why this should be zero in the event that your vector field is orthogonal to the surface. So that property is important, right? The fact that it is symmetric and it is used crucially in all of these derivations. And then we have one more fact, which is that this four-dimensional volume element can be written as a product of the lapse and the three-dimensional volume element. This again, you can justify by, for example, looking at a metric for, let's say, something like an FRW metric, right? Now, if you ask us here, what is root of minus g? Root of minus g in this case, so the metric is diagonal minus 1, a square, a square, a square, right? So root of minus g is a cubed, right? But then if you ask yourself, what is HAB? HAB is a square, a square, a square. And root of H is also a cubed. In this case, it is equal to root of minus g. Why is that? Because in this case here, the lapse is identically one, right? There it does. There is no multiplying factor of the TT part of the metric. Okay, so when you do this decomposition, right, you will find that the metric, there is a TT part which depends on the lapse and the shift. Okay, so then number 5, let's say number 10, in the 10th step in this procedure, is that once you have all of this, now you can write down the action in a form which allows you to say that you have a okay, then we can proceed with the canonical analysis. So we can ask, well, what should be our configuration variables? So we say that, for instance, our metric is our configuration variable. Okay. And this then implies that your canonical momentum would be given by the derivative of the action with respect to the time derivative of this configuration variable. But this requires us to know what the time derivative is. Now, the time derivative, as I explained in the previous class, has to be given in terms of the Lie derivative of this object along the time evolution vector field. And this time evolution vector field, can we know that it can be written as a sum of this n times n mu plus n mu times HAB, and this becomes a sum of these two, HAB plus L of n mu HAB, and this quantity is the Lie derivative of HAB with respect to the shift vector field. And when we evaluate this, what we get is something which looks like this: DANB minus DBNA. And the reason, so again, it's important to understand what the Lie derivative is to, you know, understand, to be able to follow what is going on here. So I'll come to that in 1 minute. And this part is something which is proportional to the Lie derivative of the three metric along the normal vector field. And then there is a very nice identity that if you take the lead derivative of the three metric along the orthogonal vector field, this is equal to 1/2 KAB. So in many ways, this is what justifies at the end of the day our choice of our configuration variable to be the metric. And not necessarily because one could also have taken some other combinations of the instead of HAB, one could have considered something like HAB minus some H square or some other quantity. And then we can insert all of this back. And finally, we can write down H dot. And once we have H dot, then we can take this derivative. And then we find that our canonical momentum becomes all of this and lots of algebra gives us the canonical momentum as root H KAB minus K times QAB. HAB. So in many references, you will find Q as the symbol that is used for the three metric. Having done all this, what we find then is that the Einstein-Hilbert action can be written in this form, root H times, okay, so all of those quantities actually are absorbed into minus NAHA minus NH. So this is the final form of the Einstein-Hilbert action, written in a purely 3+1 dimensional way, right? And it contains, for instance, the three metric, its time derivative, the momentum, which is proportional to the extensive curvature, and then it contains these two functions, HA and H, and they are multiplied by these two variables, N and NA dot. But now we see that the Einstein-Hilbert action does not depend on either N dot or on NA dot, right? It only depends on N and NA. So that tells us that these two objects are Lagrange multipliers. Right? And which implies that H, HA are constraints. And to respond to Debu Mallya's question from our last lecture, these are primary constraints. So constraints can be divided into primary and secondary. So if you have a Hamiltonian, for some Hamiltonian, which can be written, let's say, as a sum of unconstrained part, H naught plus some lambda I HI, where lambda I are Lagrange multipliers, then these HI, these are called primary constraints. Now, what happens is that when you have constraints, you require that those constraints should be preserved by, should have a closed algebra, right? When they commute with each other, you should get an algebra which closes. But it is possible that, for instance, when you take HI and HJ, you don't get something which is another linear combination of the other constraints. So, right? In fact, and you get something which is a new function. In this case, what you get is those new functions are called second class constraints. Secondary constraints. Okay. So in GR procedure also we get some secondary constraints, but then it turns out those secondary constraints can be made to vanish. If you want to go into the details, I will recommend Thiemann's intro to modern canonical quantum gravity, where he goes into in great depth and also in great clarity in for all these calculations. But again, it's a lot of work. So finally, we are left with the fact that we have these objects. And in terms of these two constraints, we can write down a final Hamiltonian as 1 by 2 kappa d cubed x NAHA plus NH. And this whole thing is equal to 0 on shell. Now, the thing is that after this, one has to also make sure that the phase space structure, we have to look at the phase space structure to see what happens. What are the canonical, so for instance, we can work out the Poisson bracket between the momentum and the configuration variables. And this turns out to be equal to here I'm using this symmetric notation. So what this means is when you write this as I explained a little bit earlier, this is equal to delta AB delta CD plus delta AD delta CD. Symmetrization. So these are the symmetrized brackets. Then we can calculate the constraint structure. We find out that the constraint structure that all of these, when you can calculate the commutator of HNHA and HNH, and also HA and HA. And you find that the system of constraints vanish. And so they all vanish on the constraint surface. So what is the constraint surface? The constraint surface is the section of the phase space on which we have these constraints are imposed. That means on those sections of the phase space where these functions vanish. And if you look at the commutators of these things, of these objects, we get certain other functions, which are again which are linear combinations of H and HA only. They vanish on the constraint surface. And these are called first class constraints. Okay, then one can ask, what is the physical interpretation of this HNHA? So we can calculate the Lie bracket of first what we need to do is we need to define the smeared version of these constraints. So what is the smeared version? The smeared version is just this Hamiltonian constraint smeared, integrated over the okay. So we have a interloper. Sayo, come. Just say hi. Come, say hi.
Hi.
This is my little physicist. Everybody say hi to Sayo. Okay.
She is very beautiful, Dipakda.
Thank you, Devamalia. Thank you. Sure. So that gets the curiosity out of her system, and then that's like taking the sting out of the bee, right? So what is being done, right, is integrating this function over the three manifold, and this is our smearing function. In our case, the smearing function is just the lapse. And similarly, we define the smeared diffeomorphism constraint. So, and to smear this, we need a three vector field, and that three vector field again is our lapse, is our shift vector field, right? And then we can ask, what do these objects, what is the effect of these objects on our phase space? So we can, for instance, calculate the Poisson bracket of this. So this is our smeared Hamiltonian constraint. And this is our smeared momentum / diffeomorphism constraint. Okay, so what this does is, so this momentum constraint, it depends on this smearing function, which is the shift vector field. So if you take the Poisson bracket of this with the momentum variable, what you get is that this generates the Lie, it Lie drags the three metric along the three manifold. So this is the Lie derivative of, so you have your three manifold, and then on this three manifold you have this vector field, right? It's a purely spatial vector field, and what this, as I have explained previously, any vector field is generates a diffeomorphism, right? At least in some compact region of the manifold, right? As long as the integral curves of the vector field do not develop any singularities, they don't intersect with each other, that vector field generates a diffeomorphism. It maps points of that manifold to itself. So what this does is, it takes the metric and just drags it along the surface. And similarly, if we take the Poisson bracket of this I knew I was making a mistake here. This is the effect of this constraint on the three metric, and the effect of this constraint on the momentum is similarly to drag the momentum along the three dimensional surface. And this kind of behavior, if you remember from classical mechanics, we have Poisson's equation, right? The time evolution of a, so if you have some functional on your phase space, so you have some phase space, and on that you define some function, right? And this function is, this function represents, for instance, your specification of the system, right? So if you have some probability distribution in phase space, you can represent it with such functions. Then the time evolution of such functions is given by the Poisson bracket of the Hamiltonian with the function, right? This is the quote unquote time evolution, right? Similarly, in quantum mechanics, you identify the similar Poisson bracket with the time evolution of an operator. So what is this? This can be understood in a very general way, which is independent of any particular Hamiltonian, which is that what this function H is doing, it is generating this vector field d by dt. So if you can take any function in your phase space, you don't have to take the Hamiltonian. You can take any function on the phase space. Yes, sir. There should indeed be some factors of I and H bar. So you can take any function in your phase space. I'll take G. Okay. And G gives you a vector field on the phase space, which is defined. So what happens is that you have some sort of something called a symplectic structure. That symplectic structure is what allows you to define these Poisson brackets in the first place. So in terms of that symplectic structure, one can define, one can associate. So you have some symplectic structure, which is an anti-symmetric tensor. One can associate this thing. A vector field with this function. And then if you take the Poisson bracket of this function with any other function, then what this Poisson bracket does is it this can be understood as the action of G of A, D of A, F. So what is happening is that this function G, right, is generating a vector field given by G of A. And when I take the Poisson bracket of any other function with G, I am getting the directional derivative of F along the vector field generated by G. Now, along the integral curves of that vector field, you can define some parameter. It can be any parameter. Let's call that parameter tau. So then we will say that, well, this is equal to df by d tau. Now, if this g happens to be equal to the Hamiltonian, then we say that tau is the time variable. And the above expression is time evolution. But the fact is, you don't really need to specify any particular Hamiltonian. Okay? This picture is very general. Okay? So that is what is happening here. When I take the lead, when I take the Poisson bracket of my metric of my configuration variable with respect to this function. Now this function generates some vector field in the same way, right? So that vector field, So then the effect of this Poisson bracket is to take the object on which this is acting and drag it along the vector field which is generated by that function. And since in this case we are working in a setting where we have to where things have to be invariant under diffeomorphisms, instead of the ordinary derivative we have the Lie derivative. So this is like, you can quote unquote think of it as, you know, just as you would have time evolution, you have evolution along the spatial manifold. And to be even more accurate, instead of HAB, what we should be using is some function which is smeared over the whole manifold. So we should be using something like I don't know, running out of possibilities here. Let's say cursive edge should be something which is this HAB and then smeared over the manifold using some function AAB, where AAB is some test function, okay? And then in that case, you would calculate the Poisson bracket between this H and this H, and on the right, you would get the same thing, the Lie derivative of this function with respect to the this vector. Okay. All right. So this constraint has therefore the interpretation of diffeomorphisms, spatial diffeomorphisms. All right. And the Hamiltonian vector field. Similarly, we can ask what is the effect of the Hamiltonian on our momentum and configuration variables. Now, as you might expect, the Hamiltonian generates evolution of the hypersurface, right? So the diffeomorphism constraint generates evolution in the hypersurface. The this Hamiltonian generates evolution off of the hypersurface, so along the time-like direction, and or more precisely along the time-like direction. So not along the shift part of the time-like direction, because that part is already explained by this H of A. And if you do this, you get a slightly more complicated expression. There are some other terms which depend on the Hamiltonian function and upon the Ricci scalar. But if your equations of motion are satisfied, these vanish on shell. Okay, so this, all of this tells us that the ADM formulation we want to like convince ourselves that the ADM formulation is equivalent to the general relativity, right? So in general relativity, what you have is, in GR, if you look at the degrees of freedom of GR, right? So you have the Riemann tensor, but this Riemann tensor, so if you are in four dimensions, then it is four times four is equal to 256 independent components. All right, 16 times 16, right, so 256. And, but this has various symmetries. For example, there is the Bianchi identity. Then there is the symmetry under exchange of pairs of indices. And sorry, this is the Bianchi identity. Right? So when you apply all of these constraints, right, what you find is that ultimately the degrees of freedom of your geometry are reduced to, you get 2 degrees of freedom per space-time point. Okay? And one can understand this from a different perspective, that if you start off from the linearized field equations, so in the linearized field equations, you have this h mu nu, which is your perturbation. So your metric tensor, for instance, is written as some background plus some perturbation. And then you consider the allowed degrees of freedom of h mu nu, and taking into account all the various degrees of freedom, what you find is, again, you get 2 degrees of freedom, which are the 2 possible polarizations of this of a gravitational wave. So similarly, we can look at ask the same question from the ADM formulation. So in the ADM formulation, our configuration space consists of pairs H A B and pi A B. And these are symmetric tensors. So 3x3 symmetric tensors. So each tensor has n times n plus 1 components, which is equal to 3 times 4, 12 by 2 is equal to 6 components each. For n is equal to 3. So you get 12 degrees of freedom, right? But then you have 4 constraints which come from you have 3 diffeomorphism constraints, right? One for each spatial direction, one Hamiltonian constraint, and then you get again, 8 constraints, and then, well, so this gives you 8 degrees of freedom. And then when you consider the fact I'm forgetting the exact details, but this also reduces down again to 2 degrees of freedom per space-time point after you consider some more Yeah, that's right. You have to, never mind. I'll just leave that, okay? So eventually, after taking into account all the symmetries, the ADM formalism is giving you the same number of degrees of freedom as ordinary general relativity. That's a good thing, right? Now, finally, we can proceed to talking about quantization. If you have any questions, you please ask. Okay, Mustafa. Mustafa, you had raised.
Yes, Deepak. I have 2 questions. The first one is: does the Poisson bracket of pi AB, which is the conjugate momentum with the smeared diffeo constraint, does that generate any extra terms?
It does.
Okay, and that's its Poisson bracket with the Hamiltonian, with the smeared Hamiltonian constraint. I was asking about the smeared diffeo.
Oh, sorry. One second. With the smear diffusion, no. In that case, it doesn't.
Okay. Is there any? My second question is: is there any intuitive way to see why the momentum Poisson bracket with the smeared Hamiltonian constraint generates extra terms? Is there an intuitive way of seeing it?
I'm sure there is, but I don't know what.
Okay.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Can I ask a question?
Yes, of course.
In case of in the presence of constraints, if I remember correctly, it is more suitable to use Dirac bracket rather than Poisson bracket. Is it correct? And why the Poisson bracket here works?
So let's see now. Okay, I will have to go back and look at that. Off the top of my head, I really can't give you a good answer to that. I mean, I suppose you're right that the Dirac bracket should be used, but in this case, all of this, is equivalent to using the Dirac bracket.
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
So you can use Poisson brackets.
Yeah, that's right. So I mean, we're not violating any of the rules of the Dirac procedure.
Mm-hmm.
So it's equivalent. So if you were to use the Dirac bracket, you would get the same result.
Okay. Thank you.
Mustafa, your hand is still up. Any questions?
Oh, I'll just put it back down. No, I do not have a question. It's from
Okay. All right. So now we can talk about quantization. And all right. So what is the standard procedure? Well, in the canonical approach, you start with your fields, right? They are fields, and you promote them to operators. Okay. And then you say, well, these operators, they satisfy some sort of commutation relations, which look the same, right, as the ones for the classical system. And then let's say we want to work with the Schrodinger representation. We say that the effect of our operators, this momentum operator, can be written as a functional derivative with respect to the metric, and our states become functionals of our configuration space. So our state is a functional from our configuration space to the complex numbers, where C is the space of three metrics. Okay. And then now the question is, well, we need to define an inner product on this space. Right. So one would hope that there is some sort of a measure on this configuration space, such that with respect to that measure, right, one can uh, one can perform this integration. And also this measure should be diffeomorphism invariant, right? So if you have two different metrics which are related to each other by diffeomorphisms, then you should get the same inner product, right? But the problem is that there is no such measure, at least that. That people know of. Okay, one question. Right, so Devo Mallya is also asking the same question about the Dirac bracket. So again, as I said, in this case, the analysis would give you the same answer, whether you use the Dirac bracket or the Poisson bracket. And I can try to find some resolution for that. Right. Okay. So yeah, I mean, what the Dirac bracket in this case turns out to be is that, again, if you have two states on your two functionals on your phase space, the Dirac bracket is your Poisson bracket plus something which looks like this. Phi prime. So it's your usual Poisson bracket. And plus these some other terms where right. So this phi I, these are some constraints that we get. And but it happens that it so happens that on shell this Cij vanishes. So, which means your Dirac bracket reduces to your Poisson bracket. Okay. Now one can ask it is all on shell. So will this not create problems in the quantum theory? Because you know in the quantum theory one doesn't necessarily. Stay on shell. You have all these questions, and I honestly there are many. I don't know the answer to all of these questions. Again, for those of you who are interested in more details of this, I recommend you to Thiemann's book. And so I will just read from Thiemann what he says. So the Dirac bracket is seen to have the property that we can set the second class constraints equal to zero, whether before or after evaluating it. Because of this, and because the equations of motion and the gauge motions generated by the first class constraints, so the gauge motions generated by the first class constraints are these Lie derivatives. These are the gauge motions, the diffeomorphisms, are unaltered irrespective of whether you use the Poisson bracket or the Dirac bracket. So we can just forget about the second class constraints for the rest of the analysis. Okay. And then there is, there's a lot of detail about why this is the case, but that doesn't really give us any more insight. Okay, so Devo Mallya, again, I would refer you to Thiemann's lectures, which go into all of this in great detail. Okay. So but it doesn't affect, so look, I mean, again, all of this is, I mean, especially when it comes to general relativity, it comes mathematic, very mathematical. And it doesn't affect the ultimate quantum theory, right? And so a lot of the results that we do use, we go by faith, right? So we rely, for example, on the work of people like Thiemann and Lewandowski, and also Abhay, right, Ashtekar. But so if one, you know, says that, well, you have to prove every single mathematical proof before you can actually do the quantum theory, then I doubt that there would be many high energy physicists left in this world, right? So let's just take this on faith and see where it will take us. Well, it's not blind faith, because we are trusting in that, you know, people who are far more capable than I am and others are, have indeed gone into the depths, and they have fought the monsters, and they have seen that it doesn't make any difference. Okay. All right, so now we are going to proceed with this canonical transformations. Again, this is a sidebar, starting Dirac brackets. Okay. So now we want to ask, is it possible to construct a physical Hilbert space by imposing the requirement that H is equal to zero and HA is equal to zero on the kinematic Hilbert space? That means, is there some procedure by which you can consider the set of three metrics and three momenta such that one can even formally apply these constraints on that set, right, and obtain some functions, something which will give us some sort of a Hilbert space that we can think of as a set of physical states. Okay. Now, again, it turns out that one can formally do this, right? And we can write down this equation: h psi is equal to zero, where h is the Hamiltonian constraint, and this is called the Wheeler-DeWitt equation. But again, except for the very simple cases, the symmetry reduced cases, that this doesn't have any solution. So as an exercise, I can suggest to you to apply all of these ideas. You can work with, for instance, the FRLW metric, or you can look at the Schwarzschild metric, or you can pick any other metric that you might want to play around with. And for these, you perform the 3+1 decomposition. So for the FLRW metric, for instance, the lapse function is identically zero. And the three-dimensional metric in this coordinate system, right, root of h is just a cubed. And then the shift is also identically zero. As it is, the shift is also identically zero in this case. Then one can determine the three metric and evaluate KAB. Now the question is, how do you evaluate KAB? Well, KAB, if you remember, is equal to 1/2 times the Lee derivative of this metric tensor along the time-like vector field. Sorry, the unit normal, right, the unit normal time-like vector field. So in this case, this derivative just turns out to be your normal time derivative. And so your time derivative of this becomes the extrinsic curvature. Then from all of this, you calculate the three momentum using the expressions that we have obtained previously and using the trace of this. Then you can impose the canonical commutation relations on the resulting expressions, and we can ask what is the Hamiltonian constraint. The Hamiltonian constraint will turn out to be some function of a and a dot, right? And there is no diffeomorphism constraint. And this Hamiltonian constraint turns out to be your first Friedmann equation, right? So if you look at, for instance, the FLRW metric, you get the first Friedmann equation. Then one can ask, well, what is the time evolution? Well, the time evolution, which is H dot, is given by this Hamiltonian Poisson bracket with the three metric, right? And this will give you the second Friedmann equation. So together, this ADM decomposition in the FLRW case, right, will give you the usual results that you get from your general relativistic analysis. And this is also nice because it, you know, shows you how to compute, for example, KAB and all. And at some point, I will post my own solutions to this on Zulip. Okay. All right, so we are done with this, all this canonical quantization, and it's time to get started with, we know that the canonical program doesn't work out, right? So at least not in this form. And so we can't go any further. So what do we do? Well, that is where the Ostriker variables come into the picture. Ostriker variables, or so now I will introduce all of these concepts of the tetrad and the spin connection and so on. Okay. But first, I will talk a little bit about gauge theory to remind you of what a gauge theory is. Okay, are there any other questions at this point? All right, so now what happens is that, so you have this historical progression that Amitabh Sen is looking at, trying to understand neutrino zero modes in curved backgrounds. And he stumbles upon this something called a spin connection, But then he doesn't realize that what he's actually found is a new set of variables for general relativity. That privilege went to Abhay, right? So what are these new variables, and why do we care about them? Well, the new variables. So in the old picture, what we have is we have a four-dimensional metric, G mu nu. And then we can also choose to work in what is called the first order formalism. So in the first order formalism, we treat both the Christoffel connection and the metric as independent variables. So you have your action and this kappa, in case I didn't specify earlier, is 8 pi gn. Right? And then you perform the variation of this with respect to gamma and the variation of this with respect to the metric, set both of those equal to zero separately. Then what you find is that this equation gives you the metric compatibility condition. And then when you substitute this into the expression that you get from the second variational expression, you get G mu nu is equal to zero, which is your vacuum-Einstein equation, right? So this is called the first order formalism. The second order formalism is just simply where, you know, you impose this from the very beginning, and so your Christoffel connection is determined. Okay, and then your only degree of freedom is the metric. Okay. Now, it turns out, right, so we have a different formulation of this, where instead of a metric, we can use what we call a tetrad field and a spin connection instead of these two as a dynamical variable. Yeah, one second. So this is a first order connection performance. Yes, go ahead.
So you're saying that the fact that the covariant derivative should give zero when it acts on the metric, it's not a guarantee?
Yeah, exactly. That's the point, right? You can think of it as an equation of motion that you get by performing a variation of the action with respect to the Christoffel connection.
And previously, I was asking, so in the previous formalism, you were just taking this for granted. Is that correct?
You mean in the whole canonical picture?
Canonical picture, or even if we try to calculate the equations of motion in a covariant manner, then we were taking this taking this for granted.
Yeah, I mean, it was always imposed, right?
Okay.
It's always like, you know, okay, well, this should be the case. So the thing is that if you don't say that this should be the case, you can see why this arises by treating Christoffel connection as an independent variable. Okay.
Yes, thank you.
Okay, so there is an equivalent description in terms of something called a tetrad. And a spin connection. And I will explain what all these terms mean. So what is this? What is this tetrad? Okay, so the tetrad is a choice of a local frame. That means you choose four vectors, right? And that's what this I is. I is the index which tells you which vector it is, right? So you choose four vectors. I'll write it like this, E of I, to denote the fact that for I is equal to 0, 1, 2, 3, you have four different vectors, and then each vector will have components. So these are the components. Right? These are your space-time coordinates. Now, a lot of coincidences that we will see, they happen in four dimensions, but not necessarily in other dimensions. Okay. So now, what is the relationship between what is the relationship between these variables and between this tetrad and the metric? So first of all, these variables, this we choose this vector such that. This condition is satisfied. So what this says is that if you take the dot product of these vectors using the Minkowski metric, you get the local space-time metric. Okay. As an example, again, if, for instance, we look at something like this, right? Then we can choose our tetrad to be of this form. Okay. And now if you take the inner product of any of these vectors, so you're working in, you're assuming that, you know, locally you can, if you work in a local frame, right, such observers will think that, you know, space-time is, they will be able to set up a set of four vectors, right, which will, they will call their local Lorentz frame. So in this case, for instance, we can take our local Lorentz frame. Hello, am I audible? Are you all there?
Hello?
Hi, yeah, there was a power failure at my house, and for some reason the battery backup didn't kick in. So I was disconnected. Okay. So these vectors have this property, and they have another property, which is that if you take ei j and you contract over these spatial indices, you get eta ij. So again, you can see that, for example, in this case, you write down the inverse metric, you use that to contract these vectors, you see that you will get eta ij. So what this tetrad is also known as a soldering form. So what it does is you have an internal space, which is your Lorentz space, then you have your space-time. Right? So for instance, if you have any tensor which is defined on space-time, so you have T1, mu1 to mu k, let's say, you can always take this tensor and rewrite it using these, it doesn't matter. I1, mu1, ik, muk, times t mu1. You can always write any tensor which is written in space-time coordinates using these using this soldering form. You can express it as a tensor which has these Lorentz indices. So as an example of this is the fact that, for instance, consider that you have a vector, a three-dimensional vector, okay? Right? Now, this three-dimensional vector, I can always contract it with the Pauli matrices, right? To give me a 2x2 matrix, right? And this 2x2 matrix, V alpha beta, this is a 2x2 matrix. And this is now, this has SU2 symmetry, right? And this VI vector has SO3 symmetry. So I can say that if you define a vector field on the manifold in three-dimensional vector field, if you have a four-dimensional vector field, you can just contract it with the four Pauli matrices, where the first Pauli matrix is just zero, it's just the identity, right? So you can take any vector like this and convert it into a spinner, right? So in a way, that is precisely what this tetrad basis does. It takes your vectorial or tensorial indices and converts them into these Lorentz indices. And in the earlier formulations, instead of the Lorentz indices, you would have seen spinorial indices. So if you look at the earlier literature in older literature, everything was done using this spinorial. So instead of this, you would see expressions of this form, right? Where this is your, these are your spinorial indices. And then you would take some any object like this. Okay. But in four dimensions, you have a map between SL2C and SO31, right? They both have the same Lie algebra. So SO31 is the group of Lorentz transformations. Right. SL2C is the group of two by two linear complex matrices. Right. So this is the symmetric group of spinners. Right. And this is the symmetric group of vectors in four dimensions, four vectors. But they both have the same Lie algebra, right? And that fact is encoded in this, in the fact that you can set up this these fields, these tetrad fields. Okay, so in going from this metric formalism to the tetrad and connection based formalism, it is a little bit like going from the Klein-Gordon equation. I don't know how precise this analogy is, but it's an analogy, so it doesn't have to be so precise. You have the Klein-Gordon equation in terms of some scalar field. Or you have some Dirac equation in terms of some spinorial field. And so you can write, for instance, you can write the Klein-Gordon operator as the square of the Dirac operator, right? So you can think of this phi as your metric and these fermions as your tetrad or triad. It depends in n dimensions. You would call it a n-bind. So again, we have this German word for a tetrad is called a Weierbind. In the literature, you will often see that. Weierbind. Weier means four, and bind means legs. With the operator. Gamma matrices, that's why I put a slash here. Right? So this is equal to gamma mu d. Inverter band hai kya? Okay, am I still connected or not?
You are.
Yes, you are connected.
Okay, so Sankarsan, does that answer your doubt?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Understood. Okay.
So this is one way to think of it. All right. Now, what does this like have to do with gravity, right? So we can define these local Lorentz frames at each point. Huh? नहीं बंद कर रखा था माय बैटरी बैकअप वाज टर्नड ऑफ सो दैट्स व्हाई आई गॉट डिस्कनेक्टेड ऑफ फर्स्ट टाइम ओके सो नाउ इन ग्रेविटी राइट वी हैव अ डिफरेंशियल मैनिफोल्ड राइट The metric tells us distances between between points. And what does the Christoffel connection tell us? The Christoffel connection tells us how to do parallel transport. Right? It tells us how to take vectors and higher order tensors, which are defined at one point, and transport them to some other point on that manifold. Right, and it does that because it allows us to define the covariant derivative, right? And the covariant derivative measures the infinitesimal change in any tensorial object as you go from one point to another point, right? So that's why this thing is called a connection, right? It connects the tangent spaces at different points of your manifold. But it's not a real true connection. Right? It's in the sense of being the section of some fiber bundle. Okay. So if instead of a metric, we work with these tetrad fields. So if you specify the tetrad field at each point in space time, you are specifying the metric at each point. But then you also have to specify how to parallel transport vectors from point to point. So you need a connection. You need something like the Christoffel connection, right? But now you have these objects which have this index I, which I mentioned to you is a spinorial or a SO31 index. Okay, so it's like having objects which have, for instance, internal degrees of freedom, right? So if you think of a spinner field, right? If you think of a spinner field, how do you define a spinorial field? Let's say psi1x and psi2x. Right, but you can also have these transformations which act on the spinner, right? Which rotate the spinner into another spinner. So you can have some 2x2 matrix which rotates your spinner into something else, right? And this 2x2 matrix. If this is a constant, if O is a constant for your whole spatial manifold or your initial surface, then we say that it's a global gauge transformation. Right? But this can also change from point to point. Then it is called a local gauge field or local gauge transformation. Right? In the simplest case, for instance, of let's say a complex scalar field. So you don't need a spinner field. You can also look at a complex scalar. So for a complex scalar, at each point, so you can multiply the complex scalar by a phase. And again, this theta is just a It's just a complex number. And theta can be a constant. So you have a global phase or variable. In which case this theta becomes a the gauge field is defined in terms of this theta, local phase. And what happens when you have a local phase? When you have a local phase, then you need to define something called a gauge field, right? And in this case, the gauge field turns out to be the derivative of this theta, right? And what does this why do we call this quantity? Where does it come from? One second. Right. So, for instance, if we again look at the action for a complex scalar, some V for X. Something like this. Okay. So this is our action for a complex scalar field. Now, we say that our field undergoes this locally position dependent phase transformation everywhere. And then we say that, well, under this transformation, we want S to be invariant. Right? So if you want this to be the case, invariance of S under local this phase change, what happens? Well, it turns out that we need to define a new derivative operator. Right, which is called the covariant derivative. And if we take this covariant derivative and we write down the action in terms of this covariant derivative, right? Then what happens is this action, call it S prime is invariant under local phase changes. Right? So this is where these gauge fields come into play, right? When you have some dynamical degrees of freedom, let's say like spins, and those spins, your degrees of freedom from point to point, they have some internal degree of freedom, right? And that in internal space, their orientation of that space from point to point can be different. right? Then you can go further. You can define for these gauge fields, you can define certain objects like this, right? So this is the anti-symmetric derivative of this field A mu, right? And you can add such terms to the action. Right? If you do so, what will happen is you will make the gauge field also a dynamical object. Okay. Now, ultimately, ultimately we want some physical reason, some physical justification to do all this, right? So there is a physical justification. What is that physical justification? Well, it is the fact that we have a theory called electromagnetism, right? This theory has some electric fields and magnetic fields, right? So we have some Maxwell's equations which can be written in terms of these various fields. Right? But we know that these fields are not uniquely defined at any given point. So for example, I can take the electric field and I can add to this electric field the gradient of some function, right? And I can take the magnetic field and I can add to it the divergence of some vector field. What is this vector field? Let me just call it not A. I don't want to call it A. This is chi. So let me call this phi. Let me call this vector field chi. Right? So under this substitution, these equations remain invariant. Right? Okay. But now this whole structure, but now we know that, for instance, Maxwell's theory is relativistic, right? So we have the relativistic character of Maxwell's theory. So I think I'm going a little bit long. I hope that that is not a problem. Which comes about from the fact that if you calculate the vacuum equations of motion, for instance, by substituting this expression, if you take the curl of this equation, then you take the time derivative of the curl of B, right? Then after all sorts of some simplifications and so on, right? What you find is that the electric and magnetic fields in a vacuum, they individually, they satisfy the relativistic wave equation. I think this is just box of E. What is box? Box is this thing, which is minus 1 by C squared dt squared plus the gradient square. So this is called the relativistic wave equation because this is invariant under Lorentz transformation. My writing is also degenerating now, right? This equation is invariant under Lorentz transformation. So we know that Maxwell's equations have an essential relativistic character. And this thing actually, so it should be the time derivative of some.
Debug the?
Yeah.
Actually, in the case of Maxwell's equation, we usually take the gauge transformation of vector potentials and scalar potential. Here you are taking the transformation of E and B field.
Yeah, so it's equivalent, right? So I'm coming to that.
So E and in the transformation of B, there is a divergence of chi.
Mm-hmm.
But B is a vector, right? Divergence of chi is a scalar quantity.
Yes, you're right. Some mistakes I was making. Thank you for pointing that out. So the gradient of some scalar.
E and B are the gauge invariant quantities, right?
No, E and B are not gauge invariant. Right? E and B are not gauge invariant. So let me just continue. I'll just conclude with this after explaining this. Okay. So as Devamalia pointed out, you know, E can be written as the gradient of some scalar, and B can be written as the curl of some vector. But now it turns out that we can take this scalar and this vector and we can combine these two into a four vector. And then these degrees of freedom. So this four vector is our, right? This is our gauge field. And to this gauge field, we can have some. One second. We can add this thing, d mu chi, right? So this becomes. Yeah, and that's what I was making. Mistake I was making. This is d chi by theta. And there's, I think, a minus sign and a 1 by c or something like that. Okay. So I can take this a mu and I can add to this a mu the four divergence of this sum scalar chi. And under this, this is equivalent to saying that E goes to E minus one second. Pi goes to pi minus 1 by c.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yes.
D
yes.
By dt.
Yeah, and that is a vector. Yes.
Thank you.
Yes.
Thank you.
Sorry.
No. You had, I was doing something very incorrect. You're right. So under this transformation, right?
May I point out one more thing?
Yeah, sure.
In the expression of the electric field,
negative sign is there?
That should be minus grad phi minus del A del T.
Right.
There should be another mind.
Okay.
Thank you.
Yeah. No, thank you. All right. So if you have this this modification, this is equivalent to these gate conditions on your scalar potential. Okay. So ultimately, you want to construct a theory out of this AMU, because AMU is your relativistic object. It's a four vector. It transforms as four vector. Right? So how do you construct that theory? Well, it turns out that it is useful to construct an object, which now we call a curvature tensor, but earlier it was, well, in the context of electromagnetism, it's also called the Maxwell field strength tensor. Right? And then in terms of this tensor, the equations of electromagnetism can be written as these two expressions, right? So the first expression gives you two of the Maxwell's equations, which is, I believe it gives you this Coulomb's law and this thing, Faraday's law. And the other one gives you Ampere's law and the divergence free property of magnetic field. Okay. So this is fine. I mean, this is great. We now have completely relativistic expressions. But one can go further, right? One can define a Maxwell Lagrangian. Right, which has this form. And Devamalya, again, correct me if there's supposed to be a dual here or not. I always forget that. Right. So by performing a variation of this with respect to the vector field A, you get Maxwell's equations and you recover electromagnetic theory, right? So in this picture, this A is a our dynamical object, right? And now one can ask, well, what happens if you introduce matter into the picture? Well, what sort of matter? Let's say charged particles, or more, you know, generally speaking, something like a complex scalar field, let's say, right? Which can be used to model arbitrary distributions of charge matter. And then you write down the action for your matter field. Okay. Now, the question is, why is there this phase factor coming in, and how is this phase factor related to that vector field A? Right. So this phase factor comes from the fact that if you define if you take the state, if you take the field at any one point, right, and transport it to any other point, then that field will pick up this phase, and this phase will be given by the integral of the line integral of this connection A along that path. Right, so that is the relationship between this phase and this gauge field. Okay, and we now know that, well, this gauge field is what is mediating forces between particles. Right, the electromagnetic waves are mediating forces between particles. Right, so you need to have this gauge field also, and you need to have matter also, and you need to ensure that your system respects the symmetries of the gauge field, right? And to do that, your matter action requires this covariant derivative. Okay, otherwise your matter action will not be invariant under such transformations, right? So a general Lagrangian for matter plus electromagnetism will have both of these components, right? So I don't know if this is the clearest exposition that one can give as to why you need a covariant derivative. Okay. So let me again look at this expression, right? Then I have some quantum state that is defined at some point x. When I perform a parallel transport of this state from x to some other point x prime, it picks up a phase which is given by the line integral of this vector field. Okay. Now, let us take A and add to it this transformation in terms of some vector field, which is in the spatial case given by the gradient of some chi. So what will be the effect on this space? A plus gradient of chi dotted with dx. Right? So how will the phase change? You'll get A dot dx, then this integral is a total integral, right? Plus chi at x prime minus chi at x. And if you go around a closed loop, then this will be zero. Right? So this gives you a notion of how to construct a gauge invariant states in such a theory, right? You should take line integrals of the connection along closed loops. So we'll come to all of this in the next lecture. For now, I'll leave it here. Okay? And the next lecture, maybe hopefully I'll be able to supply a little bit more clarity upon some of these ideas. So ultimately, what happens is that when we write general relativity, as a gauge field, as a gauge theory, right? Then our tetrad becomes a dynamical variable. And this is the corresponding gauge field which parallel transports this tetrad from point to point. And the Einstein-Hilbert action can be written in a form which involves the curvature of this gauge field multiplied by this one or more copies of this tetrad. And we will see that expression is equivalent to Einstein gravity or the Einstein-Hilbert action. But it also brings in more questions because it tells us that, well, apart from the Einstein-Hilbert action, you can also have terms of the form F square, and you can also have topological terms, right? Because now you have a gauge field, and you're saying that this gauge field has dynamics, right? So then the question becomes, well, how will those affect your physics, right? Are those terms going to generate effects which are observable? So we will look at all those questions in the coming lectures. Okay. So I guess I'll stop it here because we've been going for rather a long time. Okay. And then later on, what we will see is that, well, the point of doing all this is that we can use the methods used to quantize gauge theories, to quantize general relativity in these variables. So there are a lot of questions that we have left along the wayside, okay? And if you are a strict originalist, then you know, dropping all of those various questions by the wayside might not make you feel very happy. But in many ways, we are following a path which is shaped more by intuition than anything else. Okay. All right, I'll stop the recording.